Good morning.
Good morning.
Today is December 5th, 2012, Wednesday. I am speaking with Dr. Tej Kumar
Tikku.
Dr. Tej Kumar Tikku. Also Colonel Tej Kumar Tikku. This interview is being conducted in Delhi. Doctor, please, can you tell me what is your desh?
What is my?
Desh. Home.
Home. My home is India.
Okay, and?
But I was born in Kashmir, if that is what you are really asking.
Yes, and where in Kashmir?
Well, I was born in Srinagar.
Okay.
Which is
the city is?
Yes, in Srinagar, which is the summer capital of Jammu and Kashmir state.
Is it your ancestral place?
Yes, it is my ancestral place.
Or was it any other village or anything?
No, no, my ancestral place is Srinagar.
Okay. For how many generations, for example, they lived, do you know?
I can recall till about 5 generations before
okay.
me. More than that, maybe.
Probably many, many more generations. Okay. Can you tell us a little bit about your neighborhood, your house? Is it a mixed neighborhood?
Well, the place I was born is called Kanikadal.
Kanikadal.
Kani in Kashmiri means stone.
Okay.
And Kadal means bridge.
Okay.
So it was a bridge
stone
made of stones.
Okay.
So it was called Kanikadal.
Okay.
It is on a tributary of Jhelum River.
Okay.
Not on proper Jhelum River.
Okay.
And that's where I was born. As far as the neighborhood is concerned, on the eastern side of Kanikadal, where I was born, this whole colony was of Kashmiri Pandits, and across the river was the colony of Kashmiri Muslims.
Pandits means Hindus.
Hindus, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Now, tell me, how was the house like? Was it a small, big, tall, brick, concrete?
It was where I was born was a small house. It was made of mud and stones and hay.
Okay.
Those were the types of stone that, those were the types of houses that existed during that period, say around 1940s, 50s.
Okay.
But subsequently in 1975, 76, we had demolished and reconstructed it as a modern house.
So it's a brick concrete house?
Yes, brick concrete glass. And
how many floors?
This was 3 floors.
And how many people lived there?
We were a joint family, my brother, his entire family, my father, my mother, me, my wife,
uncles,
their children.
Uncles?
Uncles, yes, they also lived in the house which was just next to my house,
okay.
in the same lawn, but.
Okay, okay.
So it was a big joint family.
So how many people there were approximately?
There were about 15,
okay.
15, 16
Did
people.
You go to school there?
Yes, I went to school.
So which school?
Oh, I changed many schools. I started with Hindu middle school. Then I, because my father was in a transferable job, because the capital used to move in summer to Jammu.
Mm-hmm.
So my father would move with what is called Darbar move, because the Maharaja had established that. The capital would move to Jammu, then my father would go there, then I would study there, I would come back. But I would say that most of my education took place in DAV High School, which is
what
a very good school.
DAV?
Dayanand Ayurvedic.
Okay.
It's a big foundation in India.
Okay.
It was running schools in Kashmir. And then I changed after 8th class, I went to Khalsa High School.
Khalsa, that's also in Srinagar?
That's also in Srinagar.
Did you walk to these schools or did you?
I used to walk to the school.
Okay. How far was it?
From my house, not less than 3 kilometers, 3.5 kilometers.
So you and other friends probably?
Yes, because all of us used to go nearly to the same school or the school close by, so a whole lot of us used to go together.
And what's the name of your parents?
My father's name is Sri Radhakrishnan Tikku. He is no more and he passed away in 1981.
Okay.
And my mother, Srimati Sumavati Tikku, she also passed away after Exodus. She passed away in Delhi.
Delhi,
and unfortunately, her last desire to be taken to her home once at least in her lifetime, I could not fulfill.
Okay, we'll come to that in a minute. Now, so after school, what was your profession?
Oh no, after school I went to the college.
No, no. Your parents.
No, my father was working in the he was a superintendent of a veterinary.
Okay.
But when he retired, he was working in the secretariat.
Okay. Yes. And mother was a housewife.
Mother was a housewife.
Okay. Now you went to college there also?
Yes, I went to college.
Which college?
I went to Sri Pratap College, SP College, which is commonly known as.
Okay, and also in Srinagar?
Yeah, also.
And then after college?
While I was in the college, I joined army.
Army, okay.
Yeah.
Were you there for many years?
Where?
In the army?
Oh yeah, I served for about 30, exactly 33 and a half years.
Okay, very long time now. Now tell me, you just mentioned about Exodus. When happened, why it happened? And you are a secondary witness because you are in the army, but your family were back in Srinagar, right?
Why Exodus took place, there are many reasons.
Okay.
There are immediate reasons and there are larger other reasons which took place. The larger reason basically was that for many, ever since independence, you know, Kashmir has been a bone of contention between India and Pakistan. The Exodus was directly related to this problem of Kashmir. After around 1975-77-78, particularly after Iran revolution of Ayatollah Khomeini, Islamic surge, the revival of militant Islam took place.
Okay.
This was fed by petrodollars of Wahhabi Islam of Saudi Arabia.
Okay.
And between 1973, when the petrodollars started pouring into Saudi Arabia, and till the time the Exodus, till even today, the Wahhabi school of thought has been pumping in huge amount of money and creating radical Islam. Now, Kashmir problem was a political problem. And it was a political problem that was being dealt at the political level right till around, I would say, till Zia-ul Haq came to power in Pakistan. But his coming to power, Russia's move out of Soviet Union's move out of Afghanistan and Islamic revolution in Iran, and the influence that Wahhabi Islam had created world over, all these factors turned Kashmiri political movement into a purely radical Islamic movement.
But I'm interested with how did it affect your family?
Well, the radical Islam had decided to throw us out of the valley, and they had guns with them.
But government of India also had guns?
No, government of India, okay, I will tell you. You have to understand when did this Exodus take place.
When?
This Exodus took place end of 89, December 89, January, February, March, April. The first Exodus took place, first wave of Exodus took place from 89 September, October onwards till March, April 1990, the first wave of. During this period, if you see the problems in the Indian political system, after Mrs. Gandhi's death and particularly after Rajiv Gandhi lost the first election, second election, there was instability in India. V.P. Singh, Gujral, Devegowda, all these people, Chandrasekhar, four prime ministers came and went in quick succession, though there was a vacuum in the Indian political system. That was number one. Second point was the political instability that was brought about in Kashmir due to various factors that contributed to the growth of this radical Islamic element.
And why couldn't the Hindu minority resist this?
This is a very good question you have asked me. I have carried out some kind of a research in this. The problem was that Kashmiri Hindus have been facing Islamic discrimination in Kashmir for many years.
Okay.
And slowly, because they were being politically marginalized, they were being economically marginalized, so their children in any case were going out for seeking jobs, because in Kashmir they would not get enough jobs.
Why?
Because the system that Sheikh Ubdullah introduced and which was then enforced by Sadiq and Bakshi Ghulam Ahmad and then Mir Qasim, that ensured that Kashmiri Pandits did not get the jobs commensurate with their qualification or with the level of population.
What did they introduce?
They introduced number of legislations,
okay,
which gave priority to the Muslims for, because they declared them backward and they declared us forward.
So it was a direct discrimination against a minority.
Absolute discrimination, particularly in seeking jobs, and secondly, even economic marginalization. You know, in Sheikh Obadiah, he passed a Land Resettlement Act. Mm. Immediate when the first interim government, that ensured that whatever little land was available with the Kashmiri Pandit, that was taken away from them without compensation and given to the Muslims. So they had no land, they had no jobs, and slowly, between 1947 and till about 1989, when the actual exodus took place, nearly about 1.25 million of Kashmiri Pandits had already left Kashmir Valley seeking jobs outside. Mm-hmm. But you asked me a question, why could Kashmir Pandits not do anything? Because as long as the problem remained political, they had their point of view, but they were not killed. They were not forced out of their homes. Because at the ground level, the relationship between the Kashmiri Hindus and Muslims remained by and large peaceful.
Okay.
But it is only when radical Islam came and they started killing Kashmiri Pandits. They started pasting posters that you leave this place. This is not a place. So
was that their neighbors, they were doing it who were nice before?
I know everything, because since I have written a book on the subject, okay. So I have carried out a thorough research.
Okay. Yeah, the book is Kashmir, its aborigines and their exodus. Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you.
This gives a historical perspective, yeah. And this basically deals with the exodus, forced displacement of Kashmiri Pandits from the valley in 1989-90. As far as the killings in our area, that is, if you take my house as a center point and draw a circle with a radius of 200 meters, those killings were carried out mostly by people known to us.
Really?
Yes.
They were nice to you before, George?
Yes, they used to play cricket with us. They used to play games. They used to come to our houses. Like in our house, in our place, there was a person called Bitta. Bitta is generally a pet name given to anybody, yes. Even Hindus, they have the same name. Now, this boy, he used to learn karate. So, in his locality, he was called Bitta Karate.
Okay.
Bitta Karate killed nearly all those 9-10 people who were killed in and around our house in 200 meters radius, and he knew everybody.
And nobody arrested him?
No, the administration was totally subverted. It is not just a question of he killed. He came on the television, Doordarshan, and he accepted that he killed 30 pandits, 30 persons, out of which 29 were pandits, and one was a Muslim girl who had refused his advances. Mm. Her name was Dolly. 29 white pundits, he accepted it.
And then, no, was any punishment given to him?
No, he was not even arrested.
I see.
On the other hand, see what happens. Our Indian legal system is such that unless witnesses come forward, you cannot prove the case. When militancy started, it is true all over, wherever there is militancy, nobody will come forward to give the evidence.
Yeah, yeah.
So they go scot-free. He was in jail for 7-8 years. And after that, he was released because there was no body.
No. So how was the, in your case, how did they move? How did they leave?
I'll tell you what happened. In my case, what triggered the move was the events of January 19th.
And what is that?
Events of January 19th is now observed by Kashmiri Pandits all over India as Niskasan Day. Niskasan means Exodus Day. Because on that day, it's extremely cold. In 19 January is very cold in Kashmir. On that day, there was no governor. Governor had just taken over the previous day. And the capital was in Jammu. So there was practically no government. Before 19 January, there had been killings of very prominent people like Tikal Altaplu, like Premnath Bhatt, and many others.
Okay.
So that had already created a lot of fear psychosis among Kashmiris, because we were not used to getting killed.
Yeah.
We were used to being, sarcastically being referred as Indians or something like that.
Humiliated,
but we were humiliated, yes. We suffered discrimination of various kinds, but never, we were not violently dealt with. But then, from September 14th, when the first killing took place, mm-hmm. on September 14, 1989, the first killing of a most prominent Kashmiri Pandit took place.
Who killed?
He was killed by JKLF people.
Achha.
You have to understand, between when the insurgency started in Kashmir and the killing started, the whole movement was in the hands of JKLF.
Which
right?
Jammu Kashmir
Liberation Front.
Yeah.
And this, they continued to deal with this movement till beginning of 1991.
Okay.
Then Pakistan changed tactics and they built up Hizbul Mujahideen. So whatever I am talking to you is all done by JKLF.
Okay. But was anybody arrested, anybody convicted for that murder?
No, nobody was arrested, nobody was convicted. Nobody was arrested because, as I said, the whole administration was subverted. There was no government. The governor was in Jammu. On 19 January, while he was flying into Kashmir, he could not land because the weather was bad, so he went back. On 19 January, almost every Kashmiri Muslim was on the roads. At that time, Pandit, they were saying, I have covered in this book what kind of slogan, Pakistan se kya rishta, la ilahi illallah, Pandito bhag jao yahan se, like that, otherwise we'll keep you, this is a time for you to leave, otherwise you convert, they would say raliv, chaliv ya galiv. This was a slogan. Raliv in Kashmiri means convert and join us. Chaliv, or you get the hell out of here. Or mariv, or you be prepared to get killed. So with these killings, and on that night, when almost every Kashmiri Muslim was on the road shouting slogans against Kashmiri Pandits, you can imagine kind of fear psychosis it must have built in a microscopic minority.
Okay. What about the administration? Oh, you said there was administration. What about the police?
Nobody came on the roads.
Okay.
It was so badly subverted. In fact, I have given in this book, many Kashmiri Pandits who had influence, they talked to union ministers, they talked to Government of India's cabinet secretary, they talked to chief minister, they talked to anybody, but nobody came to their rescue.
So what happened on the
19th? On that 19th night, what happened was, every Muslim was on the road around about 11:30 night.
Okay.
And they kept on shouting slogans, they kept on going towards the Kashmiri Pandit houses and towards our house, towards the Pandit colonies, wherever they were Hindu colonies. And to our surprise, which we learned later, every mosque in Kashmir, they had already prepared cassettes, audio cassettes, and they were put on the mic system. You know, every mosque has a public address system.
Yeah.
They were put. So you can imagine in a valley what a fear sight causes and what noise it must have created. So there was absolute fear. The Kashmir Pandit thought this is going to be their last night. So that, coupled with the killings in our, for example, in my lane, about two houses, they came to kill my brother. But my brother, fortunately for him and unfortunately for another boy in the same locality, both were working in the bank. They had targeted my brother. And my brother left in a leather jacket. And he reached he left the lane and joined the main street. You know, there's a main street, then there's a lane entering like in the old houses. So he went there and he decided that he needs to come back because he forgot something. When he forgot, another boy working in the bank again went out in the same leather jacket, similar leather jacket. And because the militant was waiting for him, he did not know how to recognize. He was told the man is putting on leather jacket. He shot him. His name was Anil Ban. He died of mistaken identity. He was just 26 years old. Then similarly, when these killings took place and this thing, and then there were threats.
Okay. So on the 19th, go back.
19th January.
So what happened to your family?
So after 19 January, we could not get out because messages were sent by our friends, please be careful, don't leave because you are a target. Because I was in the army, so I was a target. My brother, elder brother had been in the army, he was a target. Mostly initially there were two types of people they target, either prominent ones or who were totally defenseless, who would send message.
Okay.
Because, you know, kill one and scare thousand.
Yeah,
that was
sure.
The kind of
that's terrible.
So then my parents decided to leave. Then my elder brother, he had a friend in the police. He sent the vehicles and
was it a Muslim friend?
Hindu friend.
So how did they come?
They came in the car. My mother, my father had passed away. My mother, my brother, his wife, two children had already left during winter because they had to prepare for examination. They had already left.
And they were in Jammu.
They came straight to Delhi.
Delhi, that's it. And what about you? And what It was a private car.
Yeah, it was a private car.
And then they came to.
They came to Jammu, stayed there for a night, and next day they came to Delhi.
Why Delhi?
Because my brother had a small flat here.
Yeah, in Delhi.
Yes, in Delhi.
So, what about the other people who lived in the house?
After a couple of days, my uncle's people also left like this.
Left.
Then my sister, who was living in Rawalpura, they also left after some time. Like that, people made their own arrangements to leave. Like my sister was in Balgam, they were already here. My sister and her husband, they were here because they were with their son here. So they couldn't go back, so they lost everything.
So what happened to your house then?
Then this happened in end of 1989. Then I was when this happened, I was in Sri Lanka that time as part of IPK, Indian Peacekeeping Force there. So when that repatriation of the Indian troops took place, I went in April 1990, I went to my house to see whether I can salvage anything. So my house was, there was something to salvage, but it had been totally ransacked.
Ransacked.
There are pictures in this book. Okay. I have given some pictures in this book. It was totally ransacked. So I could get whatever little I could salvage from there. That too with the help of army people protecting me while I was taking out the stuff from there. And I brought it to Delhi.
And any of your neighbors still live there, you know?
No, at that time one of our neighbor lived there.
Okay.
Hindu neighbor.
Okay.
But in 1992 they burned the whole locality. Really? Whole locality.
So how is it like now? Do you know?
Yes, I know because we have been going there. I mean, I went there in 2000. I went in 1996 also. Then I went in 2000. Then I went in 2007. Like that. Now that whole street is occupied by the Muslims. They have created new bungalows. I could not recognize my own street. I could not recognize.
Did you sell that property?
I could not sell my property, but many Kashmiri Pandas did sell the property as a distressed sale because after all it is 20 years, they had nothing to live here. We did not sell our property.
So did somebody take the property over?
Our property has now been taken over, but that is after they asked us because they said that they will buy it ultimately. We said, okay, you start living there, but otherwise that property after it was burnt had not been taken over.
Okay, so are they paying you rent?
No, rent, nothing.
Okay, but the title is still in your name?
Title still in our name.
So, did your parents or your extended family ever try to go back to live?
To live? No, living is totally out of question. How could you live? I mean, see, the point is this. Situation is now improving in Kashmir for the last about, I would say, from 2006.
Mm-hmm.
But before that, it was completely impossible to live there. How would you live there?
So now it is
really you're not accepted, so how will you live? After all, the man who gives you milk, the man who gives you vegetable, the man with whom you have to...
If situation is a little bit better, do you know anybody ever went back?
I will tell you. There are some people who have gone back, stayed there for 4 or 5 months and found themselves comfortable wherever they were living, but that is only for a brief period. There are people who have gone as tourists. They have found that they are welcomed there by people as tourists and they have gone back, stayed there 10-15 days and come back. When we talk in terms of going back and reclaiming our land and living there permanently, that's a very difficult situation.
So your family migrated essentially to Delhi because did government give them any compensation?
Nothing.
For anything?
Nothing.
So how did they survive?
They survived because all the people who had, my brother, one brother who was married, who had a family, he was working in State Bank of India.
Okay.
So he was adjusted outside.
Yeah.
Similarly, my elder brother was also working in Life Insurance Corporation of India. So he also was getting his pay. That's how they survived.
Okay. So the family network.
Family network.
No, essentially, that's what is coming up to.
Government did pay compensation to people who were not doing anything.
Okay.
But that is... Even by today's standard, they are paying 12,000 rupees, 1,200 rupees, 1,200 rupees per person, which is absolutely meager, and Kashmiri Hindus are agitating for that, but till now they have not raised the level.
Yeah. Now, Do you know, this is a bigger question, not Kashmir. Kashmir was divided, as was India, was partitioned. Do you think anybody benefited because of partition of India, partition of Punjab, partition of Bengal, and of course Kashmir was is also divided?
See, these are two different things. Kashmir was not divided